Now, normally, I only really do Raid Shadow Legends videos on this channel, but I've been playing Dragonheir Silent Gods for a good month, I would say now. I think since the global launch, I've played Dragonheir pretty much every day since it has come out. So I've clocked a good 30 plus, if not 40 plus hours in that 1 month in terms of game time. And I've kind of held off doing a review of the game until I kind of unlocked a lot more of the game to see where it would go. A lot of the games that we kind of end up playtesting or we do a sponsorship on, they have a very great start, but I always worry how much playability you have in the long term. And I wanted to make sure that I'd got the full game in hand because Dragonheir is a very unique game. So in this video, I'm going to give you kind of a review based on my experience with Dragonheir on whether I think Dragonheir Silent Gods is a good game, whether I think it's worth playing in 2023. I'm also going to give a bit of a background in terms of the game, take you through some of the storylines, take you through some of how it works, what are the different systems and mechanisms, and give it a complete top-down, is Dragonheir Silent Gods a good game? So Dragonheir Silent Gods is set in the world of the Chaos Universum. It is an open world style game where you can move your heroes along. You can see I'm in the game right now. I have made my way all the way up to the third area, Adenthea, Tenebria. There's a South Adenthea, Netheria. You start in the Chaos Universum when you create a new hero. The hero creation is quite cool. You actually get your own playable hero, which is the Traveler. You can see my Traveler here. You can customize this. I've kind of made Emo Legolas because, you know, Emo Legolas is awesome from Lord of the Rings. You know, if anyone knows me, I love Lord of the Rings. You can customize your Traveler. This game is pretty much a hero collector, but it also has elements of D&D in terms of dice 20 rolling. It has elements of open world. It has elements of sort of dungeon farming, gearing. It's got PvP. It's got sort of, I'd say, alliance bosses to some extent, but like big bosses you can fight. There's a good storyline to it. And I have to say, this is one of the first gacha type hero collector games that hasn't assaulted you with packs the moment you come into the game. The art style is pretty awesome. You can see there is a wide range of heroes available for you to collect. I've got one legendary here so far, but there's loads of epics and rares, and they're all very unique. The graphic quality of this game is top tier. They look amazing. They feel amazing in terms of uniqueness. There are some like duplicate models. We have various forms of Nub Raids, if anyone knows who Nub Raids is. Obviously, he's a Raid Shadow Legends content creator. But here we go. We've got kind of like poison Nub Raids. We also have One-Eyed Nub Raids, who is a poisoner as well. Good old One-Eyed Nub Raids is here, just chilling out with his missing eye with his massive crossbow. There we go, we have Old Man Nub Raids as well. So there's various forms. I jest, you know, it's quite funny. But they do have some reused models, but they also have some incredibly unique models here. We've got Flora, one of the best wild champions. We've got also a pretty awesome jester dude here. This is Casper. This is the one that YST really wants to get, Casper, the friendly ghost, as I like to call him. But there's some pretty cool, unique legendaries. There's a rat folk here, a Zephy. The necrosis dudes are very, very cool as well. We've got sort of angry old man, undead Gandalf going on here with his massive staff. So the graphic quality of this game is top tier. You will not find a better looking game than this game here. The open world roaming I have found to be quite manageable. There's lots of fast travel points. It doesn't cost you anything to move around the map. You unlock things as you go. So for example, if I want to go to this Fey Meander section, I can literally just click on the map and fast track it. If I want to come back to content in the future, I can also set custom labels. Some of the sort of different game modes I sort of come back to later on. So you can just put a little mark on it. All of these little portals you can teleport around. So it's really easy to find yourself around the world. You can see here, I've created a little marker of the tower here that I've created that I haven't been able to complete. So I can just teleport, fast travel, quick loading screen, and you actually end up there. There's a very diverse set of lands as well. And as you're going around the open world, you can pick up some resources. When you first start picking these up, you'll get your hands on some premium currency, but then they just give you some cooking materials, which is a kind of a cool game mode in the game. And I have not found the open world to be any way problematic to the core concept of hero collecting and building your heroes. There's lots of different game modes here. So it's a hero collector. So you will summon heroes here. You can see I've summoned a wide range of heroes. We've got epics, we've got rares, and you can build them up. Now, the cool thing about this hero summoning system is there is very good mercy rates. in the sense that when you start the game, you might not get this now if you decide that you want to start the game after watching this, because this Echoes of the Other World will be over. But when we started with Season 1, we basically had 80 summons here, and if you summon 80, you basically get a free legendary on top of those 80 summons. In terms of the summoning here, you get Heliolite Dices, which are sort of like, if you play Raid, your Sacred Shard types of things, where there's a 3% chance for you to get a Legendary Hero, a 17% chance to get an Epic, and an 80% chance for you to get a Rare. But if you don't summon a Legendary after 35 usages, you're guaranteed a Legendary. There's no escalating mercy system like you see in Raid Shadow Legends or other things where after a certain point you start getting closer. If you don't summon one in 35, you get a legendary. We also have, for example, Starlight Summons. So the Starlight Summons are almost like ancient shards where you don't really get legendaries here, but you can get epic champions. So you could, there's a 3% chance to get an epic and 20% chance to get a rare. If you don't get a rare within 5 pulls, you get a guaranteed rare. So the mercy system here is pretty good. Now, you may have heard me mention seasons. Really what makes Dragonheir very unique is their seasonal feature. So we're in Season 1 here now. You can see it's going to end in 64 days. So every 3 months, Dragonheir is going to move into a different season. And it's going to kind of do a bit of a soft reset of the game, which sounds alarming. It sounds terrifying. And of course, we're actually not anywhere near the seasonal reset yet, so we don't know what the impact is actually going to be properly. I think people who played the beta of this game, they call it Season 0, have some sort of inkling of how it's going to be. But you don't lose everything that you acquire. They just kind of give it a soft reset and they change the game mode up a little bit. So we can see it kind of explains how the reset works here, where you basically keep your heroes, but they reset them back to level 1. You keep your artifacts, but they get reset back to level 0. You keep something called Essence of Creation, which you need to upgrade artifacts with. You get artifacts by being able to summon duplicate champions. I'll go into that a little bit in a little bit of detail without going into too much detail. But you get to keep your Heliolites, your Essence of Creation, but it gets reset. They have the Echo of Clepsydra, which is kind of like seasonal rewards at the end of the season. And anything that you've bought in the game in terms of Wyrmarrow, Dragon Crystal, Summon Dice, Skill Scrolls, and any consumed will be reserved until the next season. So you basically keep all those items as you go. Anything that you've earned in terms of seasonal rewards, in terms of an avatar frame, will be kept. The psychic core is also kept, which is part of your character, but the world and the elemental affinities are completely reset, and the elements basically change the way that you will play the game. What was quite cool about this as well was in the first 144 hours of the season, you basically could experiment with different heroes that you acquired. You can build them up, you can use your resources, and then throw them into this rebuilding, and you got everything that you spent back, which is very, very good for people who wanted to kind of learn the game. I use this a lot to kind of go, I wonder if this hero is good, boost it up. A lot of the time in Raid Shadow Legends, for example, or in Watcher of Realms or in other of these things, once you've invested in the hero, you've kind of got to commit early to know that that is a hero you're going to want to do, because you can't really reroll those, you can't get it back. The fact that you can spend a bit of time experimenting with those heroes to actually figure out, you know, are they good, do they fit well, are they a champion or a hero you want to use, but you actually get the resources back if they're not, was excellent. Very well played out. So this seasonal reset as well has had like seasonal staggering of content, and it's really been quite different. I've not really experienced this in a game before, where they've essentially been staggering the content releases bit by bit. So recently they unlocked a new game mode called Pillar of Trials. So the way that they have managed sort of the game is as you progress, they're going to unlock things for you in the season. Whereas other games, you basically hit level 20. It's like, great, now I've got 1,200 new game modes. What do I do now with this? Do I do this game mode? Do I do that game mode? They haven't done that in this in Dragonheir. They've basically managed the game for you so that you can basically play the game and focus on what you should be focusing on rather than wondering if you need to do this game mode. They've just unlocked, for example, over here in the arena. They have competitive gameplay, which is very good. They've only just unlocked Tag Team Arena. Why? Because I haven't had the resources yet to build up another set of 3 teams. So they are kind of staggering this content to go, hey, just focus on the main arena first. Don't build 3, because you might be tempted to waste your resources over here building these up when you don't need to. So overall, the open world has been an excellent experience. The summoning of heroes has been a pretty good experience as well. It does get quite expensive. There is a paywall to some extent to get in the legendary heroes. But I've actually found, without any legendary heroes in this account so far, I've only been able to summon 1. We got 1 free one from the season, which is Eric. and that is the only legendary heroes I've got, and I don't really use either of them. I'm able to progress in the gameplay pretty comfortably with just a good set of rare and epic champions. Some of these rare champions are incredibly powerful. This Sigrid here, for example, is an absolute god of a champion. It one-shots things with its ultimate. It can get that ultimate energy back. It is really cool. You can build your heroes any way you want to, really, and there is no cost to doing it. There's lots of hidden features and hidden gems in Dragonheir that I have not really been paying attention to and discovering along the way. For example, there is an entire plan section here where if you have four sets of artifacts that are incredibly good, that are like the perfect balance for crit rate, crit damage, attack, you can literally just go, okay, this is my best damage in build. I can say damage build, excellent. And then if I want to try out a new damage dealer, say I wanted to make Arena my best champion for damage, I can come in here and I can say, hey, I want to use this abilities, just equip all this in one go, and it doesn't cost me anything. I can move gear around for free. It does get expensive in terms of gold to level up the epic gear. In the early game, I wasn't really struggling for gold. Now that I'm getting further along the game, gold is becoming quite expensive to get up to these level 16s, so you really have to manage that better. But actually swapping gear around, you can experiment, you can move things, you can do whatever you want, which is really, really cool and very kind of freeing. It means you can experiment with different teams and different combinations. And in Dragonheir, that is really important because of the elements. This game is very much focused around elements, and you have to almost index into specific elements to get the full value. Right now, we have a seasonal setup of Radiance, Lightning, Fire, Poison, and Ice, Necrosis. So your elemental bonuses from your own hero will improve the benefits if you have matching elements of that type. So if you put your Lightning and Radiance together and you have three of them, you're going to get all these bonuses. And then eventually, once we progress through the season, the five hero element affinities we're going to unlock, and those will progress through you as well. So it's really encouraging you to build similar affinities. But not just that, each hero has their own type. So in the hero type here, we're also kind of like planning around how we want to build teams. So for example, there is a type called Rally, and most of these Rally heroes benefit from an effect called Rally. For example, if we take a look at Kayle's here, Kayle's, when she has Rally, deals 35% more damage. And Rally is just a concept that happens when they are doing something. They can give themselves Rally often on a basic attack or when they are doing something else. For example, we have Martina here. Martina on her A2 will give herself Rally in this battle skill. And then when she has Rally, she can guarantee a crit and ignore 40% of the defense on that A3. So the idea with these combinations are you want more Rally together because these heroes will interact with this same type. For example, if we look at Alvis here, when the hero carries no Rally, the hero will duplicate Rally if any other ally on the battlefield gains Rally. So it's all about stacking all these combined efforts together. Wild is pretty particular with Eric. Eric will gain sort of chances when wild checks are happening. Wild champions will have a 30% chance to roll a dice. If it's successful, they do a lot more damage, but heroes interact with each other. So if more wild check happens, this champion here will improve the odds and deal more damage. That is kind of like how that it works. That is at a cost, because if you haven't got enough of the same type of champion, then you are struggling to build a wild team. If you don't have very powerful champions in the wild kind of role, then it can be problematic. But it does create a compelling challenge for you as a player to build teams. And they've introduced game modes that require you to do that. When we go over to this Pillar of Trial, which is kind of like a Doom Tower climbing mode, you can see that you actually have to build different teams for each affinity. You're locked out in Pillar of Light. You can only use the elements here for the Radiant and the Lightning. So you actually have to go and build these teams up to be able to progress this tower. So from a game mode point of view, it's quite diverse. We've got different trials, we've got different bosses. The story is quite compelling if you're into RPG elements. They've really dug into the RPG elements of Dungeons & Dragons. They have integrated a lot of the Dungeons & Dragons sort of core concepts. For example, this is your hero. As I said, you can design this hero. It's almost got a character creation with it. You've got attributes here. You can choose where you want to put your attributes, and they have an impact in the game. If you want to steal more things from people in the world, then dexterity is the way to do it. If you want to win more arguments, you know, you want to win some compelling things to force a person to believe you, then obviously charisma and wisdom is better. And as you progress through the game, you will get some horizons to be able to upgrade these things. We have some elemental powers. The cool thing about your traveler is you can change their elements so they can fit the team that you want. They all do different things. It doesn't cost you anything to do this. It's really, really cool. There is an identity here where you can basically kind of like, when you create your character, you can define what you are. I've defined myself as an archaeologist. Emo Legolas archaeologist, that's what I am. And it gives you different benefits where you can sense the ground and you can use various different things. Then we have the elemental affinity here, which is kind of like a mastery tree progression. As you complete different things, you will get affinity solvent. And then you can start indexing towards benefits like accuracy, attack percentage, and then these five element bonuses here for your various affinities. This is all about building the right balance of teams. So in the early game, you can get away with having a three of the same affinity with spear ones. As you start climbing, then you're going to need to have five of the same affinity or elements here. So there's lots of compelling ways to build heroes, build teams, and build different things. Now, in terms of the gameplay and the actual combat, it is quite strategic. You can see a massive difference in the way that you place your heroes. If you've played anything like Eternal Evolution, which is a game that released recently, then that would be a kind of a combat system you're used to. It works in a grid-based system of placement. So you can see as I come into battle here, I've got a grid in which I can place people. Their abilities will be defined based on the grid system here as well. So you need to keep that in mind. For example, my Hexandra is a healer, one of the best healers in the game. And she has this triangular, whatever you want to call it, style grid. So it will not work if I've got my hit one, my damage dealers over here and this over here, because either I'm only going to heal a single hero or I'm going to heal all my team, but not that hero here. So placement is very important. There's also a diverse set of opponents with various different elements. This necrosis guy here, for example, is immune to necrosis damage. So you wouldn't be able to bring any necrosis heroes. He also has a very frustrating shadow assault. We also have auras here, so you can kind of play this. There's food that you can apply. There's a lot of depth and a lot of diversity to the combat. And when we get into the combat here, we can see how it works. You can see the power-up bar is their ultimates. And this is where it's scary. We've already lost our shield guy. We're now going to lose our healer. So we basically can set this up here. And hopefully we're going to survive this, but we're probably going to lose. Set the debuffs up. And Sigrid is going to basically one-shot anything with a debuff. Very strong damage dealer. I am towards the end of the campaign, or towards the latter half, so a lot of this content is very difficult. These summoning ones are very dangerous at the moment for my team. So we can see that the campaign battles are equally as strong as normal dungeons. Now, any good hero collector game has a deep gearing system, and this also has a good gearing system. I wouldn't say it's advanced as something like Raid Shadow Legends and other games that I've played in terms of gearing, but it is deep enough that you can have some compelling decisions. It is all framed around a number of dungeons you can farm. You would farm goblin layers to basically get experience to make new higher rank champions, to upgrade champions. They do have element dungeons to farm crystals that you require to take them up to different ranks. And then there are principal dungeons here for Grave of Venom, Grave of Curse, Grave of Rot. These are the gearing dungeons. Now, the cool thing I like about this is you can try and push to higher difficulties, but if you fail, you don't lose your energy. Energy is very sparse in this game. It's in the bread system here. It basically recharges at a rate of around about, I'm not entirely sure what the rate is, but one refill a day is kind of the natural flow. So you get 120 with 120 probably over the day. And you do need to spend 15. So farming food is quite difficult. It does force you into one of their monthly subscription offers. We'll talk about the subscription and the pay to win elements in towards the end of the video. So you are encouraged to do that if you want to play the game seriously. But what you can do is you can try and push to stage 7. If I push this to stage 7 here, it will ask me to consume 15 food. It tells you a bit of information here. But if you fail, then it's not a major problem because you'll get that food back. You're not wasting energy. Other games that I've played, you have to commit the energy up front, and then you need to know that you're going to win, or if you're not, you want a consistent run. Here, you can actually just run this in this fashion. If you fail, then you can try a different deployment system. You can try different heroes. You can test different things out. The world's your oyster. You can see stage 7 I'm not ready for. I haven't beaten stage 7 yet. My tank is pretty good, but my backline gets absolutely one-shot by what I like to call the Witch King of Dragonheir. He looks exactly like the Witch King from Lord of the Rings Online. So you can see we're going to just keep doing this. He's going to one-shot us eventually. This is how this boss works. Slamming it away. Our tank just doesn't want to die for some reason. But we can basically end this knowing this would fail, and we get our food back. We doesn't lose anything, which is really cool. It will tell us kind of like the death replay log where we lost, how much damage was cast. We can kind of see suggestions. It even gives you recommendations from other players, and you can tell it, hey, don't show me legendary champions because I haven't whaled in this game. And you can see there are different options, and you can kind of make a thing. It even allows you to watch that person's run, so you can kind of get an idea of what they did to make it work, because you can watch the run that they did, which is really, really cool. It's a great feature to help people learn how to play the game and understand what they need to do. So what are the rewards like in the game? Well, we have some events that go on continuously. Right now, there are some sort of seasonal based events. There's a daily login system here where you can get yourself some legendary summons. They give you a free epic champion who actually is one of the best tanks in the early game, the mid game. I don't know what the progression states is, but it's one of the best tanks for you. So it's like they've given you a really good epic to get started. You do get dice legendary books here summoning, and if you continuously log in all the time, you'll also get some cumulative login rewards here. So some essence of creation, some Weir Marrow. This Weir Marrow is their premium currency. You can also get some bonuses from connecting to the community. There is a referral system where if you get some people bonded to you and they get to level 25, you get a free legendary summon, which is really cool. There is a free legendary available by beating the campaign. You can see I've beaten the campaign story here. You also get free legendary summons. It's very rewarding as you play through the game. They often do hero training events. These are like dungeon divers. If anyone's played Raid, they know dungeon divers events. These are like dungeon dive events where pretty much anything you do, you get points. And then you can work towards those points, and then you get these bonuses here. If you finish in a certain ranking, you also get some additional rewards as well. As long as you're in the top 50%, which I've always been without even having to try hard, you get some bonus rewards. If you finish the one, cool. Obviously, there are Krakens in this game. You won't be able to compete with them, especially if on this server here where I've got a lot of the Season Zero Krakens. There's also a battle pass, which I actually think is incredibly good value for money if you like this game. You get all of the free reward at the top here, totally free, and it is completed by completing daily quests and completing weekly quests in the game. You can also see there's like summoning epics, what you would typically expect from a battle pass system in the game. The free version actually is quite rewarding. You get a legendary summon there. There's some philosopher stones. We're very kind of, the story is very brand heavy with various different like tropes from other fantasy stories. We've also got some books here to upgrade the skills of your heroes. Food refreshes, more summoning, more Weir Marrow. There's lots here, but the actual paid pass I think was about $19.99, so $20, and you get a lot of rewards. For $20, you basically get 7 legendary summons, a legendary scroll, the Avatar frame, 1,000 Weir Marrow, which I've been basically converting those Weir Marrows into more legendary summons because of the way that the summoning system works. I'll talk about that in the pay to win section of this video. We get more of these crystals so you can actually craft some more gear in your camp. Essence of creation, really valuable. Some XP. So you get a lot for $19.99. There is also your daily commissions and different trials and sort of, these are like achievements. If you complete certain things, they're going to give you even more rewards. You are constantly getting something for doing something in the game, which feels really good. It feels like everything I'm working towards, it pays off. Whereas in other games I've played in the past, it feels like I'm running something for the sake of running it, but it doesn't actually pay off for me. So let's talk about the currencies in the game. There is gold, use gold to upgrade gear. There is Weir Marrow, which is kind of like the premium gem. That's kind of what you use to buy extra food, or you buy extra arena battles, or mainly you use it to summon heroes. There is also a Dragon Gold. This is the premium, the stuff that you buy. You can only get this by buying it, and essentially it serves its purpose to convert into Weir Marrow. I think it's just been created to get around laws and legislation. It's there just to basically give you more Weir Marrow. You buy it in the store, you convert it to Weir Marrow, and then you use the Weir Marrow however you want. The store is, there's some elements that are really good. For a low spender, this game is very friendly. You get a lot for spending very little. But then the gap between spending very little and spending what you need to actually compete at the top is very big. That's kind of how I would describe it. They often do these free little things to kind of go, hey, if you buy this for the first time, you're going to get double, right? These are like the payment conversion models. Can you buy this for me straight away so I can make you into a spender? And once you've spent once, you're probably going to spend again. So I'm going to give you double to encourage you. You can see the difference here. All of these would give me double if I've bought them for the first time. But once I haven't bought them for the first time, I get 10%, It's a massive difference. But these value packs are kind of like the gem pack, the daily packs. They're very good for the price point. For $4.99 a month, you're going to get yourself 350 Wyrmarrow, which is equivalent to one legendary dice. And then you're going to get food and auto battles, and you get 20% more gold. And that'll be continuous for the next 30 days. If you want the gem pack, it's $9.99 and you get 3,000. And I think that's split by 100 a day. And then you get 700 instantly. So you get essentially two Heliolite dice, two summons. For basically a monthly plan of $9.99, $4.99 for $15, and then the battle pass at $20. So $35 a month, you're going to get a hell of a lot to play this game. You're not necessarily going to get thousands and thousands of legendary champions, it feels like. You're not going to get lots of chances for there, but you're going to get everything you need to play the game, which is a big deal. Whereas I think in lots of other games, you have to spend probably upwards of $100 in one go just to get one of something. But here is where the gap changes. If you then want to go and buy actually summoning, it's stupidly expensive. If you want 16 summons here, it's $100. If you want to buy any sort of books, it's $50. This becomes incredibly expensive if you want to buy anything else in the store. So there's this gap of the daily packs are pretty good, but the big packs are really expensive, but they never actually tell you to go buy these. You're never constantly prompted. You're playing the game as if it's a game. It's not a shop that they need to sell you something. Yes, the Wyrmarrow subscriptions exist. Yes, those packs exist. And if you want the legendary summons, like me, I haven't spent that much. I've bought the battle pass. I've bought some of the other summons. I have bought a little bit to guarantee myself a legendary. Here you can see I'm sitting on 20 Heliolites. I'm going to do another video with YST where we're going to talk about the game and the experiences that he's had with it. I'm going to have a bit of a collaboration, but he's going to tell, we're going to basically summon it here. I'm doing it purely because this guarantees me a legendary, but I haven't really spent beyond the battle pass and the monthly packs, and I found a lot of value and a lot of enjoyment out of those. So the hero system does have a feature here where you can't actually acquire duplicates of the champions. There isn't really a dupe system. You can't run more of the same champions. Once you've acquired the hero, you keep that hero. You can't get more of the hero. What they will give you instead is Essence of Creation, which is used to upgrade artifacts and materials to exchange those artifacts, this currency here, for those artifacts. So you can see if you pull a duplicate epic, you'll get 5. You'll be able to pull one of these items. And these items are incredibly powerful. If you have a shield champion, you can just get 15% more. Now, it does scale to an incredible level if you pull duplicate legendaries. Some of these artifacts are incredibly powerful, the exclusive ones specifically. So you can't pull the same champion multiple times, but you can pull them, but you just don't get to keep them. The legendaries do have a duplicate system with them called Inspiration. I haven't really looked into this at all myself, but I would imagine it just kind of makes legendaries even stronger. Legendary champions are incredibly powerful in this game. There's no way of putting it. If you have Flora for Wild, or if you have some of the rally champions, they do make a huge difference to this game, and you can't really compete with the rares. But the rares and epics are more than adequate for you to play the game with a good level of enjoyment where you don't feel like you can't compete. So I've talked about the review. I've kind of given my thoughts on the experiences that I've had in the game. I'm really enjoying Dragonheir, and I am a type of player that either I go all in on the game and I really like it, or I play it for a little bit, don't like it, and I'll never touch it again. I find it very difficult to get sort of hooked by games these days. I play Raid a lot. I sometimes play a little bit of Total War games. I don't really have time to play MMO games anymore. And I used to play League of Legends, but I don't. The other game that I play a lot of is Diablo 4. But again, I don't play it as much as I have played Dragonheir for the last 30 days. So that's a good sign to me. That tells me that this game has a lot of depth to it, and I've still got a lot of progression to go. I've only just got into this area here. I've got loads of teams to build. I've got the Fey Meander, which is another type of Doom Tower thing where you climb and you get lots of rewards. I've got to start climbing that as well. I'm waiting to see what legendary champions I'm going to get out of my 20 Heliolite dice. Because as I said at the start of the video, you can predict how many dice you need to get a legendary. I know I've only had one legendary out of the 65 summons so far. So I'm 5 summons away from a guaranteed legendary. So I know within 15 summons, I'm guaranteed to get 2 legendaries. And that consistency is really nice in these types of games. It's the first time I've seen any sort of mercy system where it feels like I can actually make a judgment call on what I'm going to, you know, when I'm going to achieve it. And pulling that legendary, if it's, for example, a wild legendary or a rally legendary, it might make my decision about which heroes I start working for my other teams, which is why I'm kind of like waiting for those things to kind of upgrade. But there you go, guys. Dragonheir Silent Gods. It's got a lot of investment behind it. It's being developed by some big people. I think the owner of this game is being published by the owner of TikTok, ByteDance. You know, this game has a lot of power behind it. The implementation so far has been very friendly from a pay-to-win model. Yes, there is pay-to-win aspects. Yes, there is gacha aspects, but it's not thrown in your face. There's deep gearing. There's cool hero collections. There's unique mechanics. The combat is strategically engaging. And there is a good diverse set of rewards and game modes that will keep you chasing. I haven't really talked about one specific type of game mode here, which is there's lots of puzzles that you have to do in the world. You have to do tower defenses, there's unlock puzzles, there's different rolling of the dices, there's different movements. They've tried to make the gameplay a little bit more than just put five heroes in and hope you win. There's a lot of diversity to it. And I will tell you, the boss battles are extremely fun. They're very cool. So good job on the game so far. I'm really enjoying it. I might continue doing a little bit of content on this channel. So really, let me know, guys, in the comments below. Are you playing Dragonheir? I wasn't sponsored to make this review, this video. I did it because I've had a lot of fun. If you're playing and you're enjoying it, let me know in the comments below. If you guys want to see more Dragonheir videos from me, if you want some guides, if you want some help, if you get stuck, if you want me to do more videos in terms of like content that I'm clearing, then let me know. If this video does well, I might cover Dragonheir a little bit more alongside all the other stuff we cover on this channel. If this is your first time to this channel, make sure you hit that subscribe button if you've really enjoyed this content and you want to see more from this channel. We do live stream raid a lot, but we also live stream some Diablo and some Dragonheir from time to time. There is a new Diablo season coming up, which I'm really looking forward to playing. We also do raid videos pretty much most of the time every day. I try to keep a fairly regular upload schedule. So yeah, if you want to see more of this content, hit that subscribe button, hit the bell notification, hit a thumbs up if you really liked this review, and I'll catch you guys in a future video.